Brethren, owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth his neighbor hath fulfilled the law. For thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is comprised in this word, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The love of our neighbor worketh no evil. Love, therefore, is the fulfilling of the law. The Holy Gospel. Taken from St. Matthew chapter 8. At that time, when Jesus entered into the ship, his disciples followed him, and behold, a great tempest arose in the sea, so that the ship was covered with waves, but he was asleep. And they came to him and awaked him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And Jesus saith to them, Why are ye faithful, O ye of little faith? Then rising up, he commanded the winds and the sea, and there came a great calm. But the men wondered, saying, What manner of man is this? For the winds and the sea obey him. Thus are the words of the sacred scripture. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Today we have the happiness of the first Holy Communion for Kateri, her baptismal name. And today you receive our Lord for the first time, the living God who comes to you in the body, blood, soul, and divinity of the Holy Eucharist. He invented this. Christ invented this. Only God can invent something so, take me correctly, so insanely excessive of love. Not even the pagans, says St. Thomas Aquinas, ever dreamt of God becoming our food. They never dreamt of that. But God did. Because his love is infinite. And love, if you ever stand next to a huge, powerful waterfall, Kentucky is full of waterfalls, so is New York State, and massive waterfalls with tremendous weight crashing over the edge of the cliff and crashing and thundering down below. So the love of God is like that. It's like a massive waterfall. And the devil and men try to stop his divine love, but that doesn't stop it. And he pours out his divine love on the cross, firstly. So the cross is the first major waterfall of God's infinite love, pouring out from his five wounds the fountains of all grace. And from the five wounds, we have all the graces poured out through the seven sacraments. When we go to confession, it's his precious blood that washes the soul whiter than snow. When we're baptized, it's his precious blood that cleanses the soul, poured out of his five wounds on the cross. When we receive extreme unction, if you're in danger of death, or if you're married, and marriage is unique because the ministers of the sacrament are the spouses, and that the flood of God's grace is always pouring out on the marriage all the time, like a happy cloud pouring out not rain, but rains of God's grace all throughout your marriage. Always. Always. That's why marriage couples have to always remember and trust in that nuptial grace to help them through difficult times. And then the sacrament of holy orders, of course, of the priesthood. That's a tremendous outpouring of the love of God. Through a poor man made of clay, God pours out his graces. The Sacred Heart of Jesus through priests. He wants priests. And that's why Archbishop Lefebvre so clearly understood that the heart of rebuilding after this collapse of Vatican II, 53 years now, the heart of any rebuilding is seminaries to form good priests. Of the church. So ask your prayers for our seminary of Our Lady Mount Carmel in Kentucky. We have 15 young men studying there, generous young men. Pray for them all. And pray that one of the bishops of Archbishop Lefebvre will rise and stand up like they should and ordain these boys when the time comes. Pray for that. And then, of course, in the other sacraments, but especially the Holy Eucharist. The Holy Eucharist is unique because, as St. Thomas will say, when you look at the sun, you see the rays of the sun coming out. So the six sacraments are like those rays of light pouring out Christ's grace from his burning sacred heart. But the Holy Eucharist is not one of the rays of light. It is the burning sun. It is the burning heart of Christ himself in the Holy Eucharist. It is his real body, his glorified body, which stands at the right hand of the Father now. You receive that. You really receive his precious blood. It's the infinite price of Christ's precious blood. This is the sweetest wine. It's the most refreshing drink for the soul. You drink his precious blood in the Holy Communion. You don't see the blood, but you do receive that. And St. Ephrem says your mouth, St. John Chrysostom rather, says your mouth is stained with his blood. And the devils see that and flee. Receive communion. And then you receive his soul, the very soul of Christ. That's something unique because the soul is united to the body, and Christ's soul was united to his sacred body, and they're both divine. And then you receive the divinity of Christ himself, that flaming, burning, divine heart of Jesus. You eat that fire. When you go to some of these Japanese restaurants, they eat fire, right? They put the fire down their throat and they impress the crowd. But you, in communion, you really swallow this divine fire. And it burns in us. He catches us on fire of his divine love. And he burns off the rust of sin. That's what he wants to do. So this is the power of the seven sacraments. So it's no wonder the devil has unleashed with Vatican II and the new Mass and the whole new updating and changing of the seven sacraments. They're often doubtful, at least, and invalid for sure, when there's not the proper matter, form, and intention. So remember the scandal of Cardinal Bernardine in Chicago years ago, allowing the people to make their own hosts. So they were coming to church, bringing their hosts for Mass, and when they made the host with butter, Crisco oil, sugar, brown sugar, egg yolks, was this valid host? No. Yeah, Christ laid down pure wheat flour mixed with water. Only that can be, when cooked and shaped into the sacred host, when the words of consecration are pronounced, that truly changes into the body, blood, soul, and spirit of Christ. But if it's anything made of anything other than pure wheat flour and water, it's invalid matter. Just like baptizing, if someone baptizes with Coca-Cola, is it a valid baptism? Not at all, because Christ laid down water. Not even the Pope, with all his authority, can change these laws. Nor can any Pope change the Catholic faith. Are introduced novelties. And St. Peter, the first pope, remember in Galatians, the book of Galatians, St. Paul says, I had to withstand and resist Peter to his face. The first pope, I had to correct him publicly because he was weakening on questions of the Jews and Jewish ceremonies and Jewish practices. And no longer is the Jewish religion true. The Jewish religion is dead, it's finished. Once Christ died on the cross, that sealed it, and God even showed his hand in it by ripping the veil of the temple, which was 60 feet high. He ripped it in half from top to bottom to show the Jewish religion is now fulfilled. The Lamb is now sacrificed, and that is our Lord Jesus Christ, who is to truly, truly God. So, for all of us, every Mass should be like the First Communion. One of the saints said to the priests, Priest of God, say your Mass like it was your first Mass. Say your Mass like it was your last Mass. And St. Peter Julian Eymard says that also. Every one of us, receive communion like it was always your first communion. And receive communion like it was your last one. And always ask with every communion the miracle of a true conversion and to love God with all our heart. Because how many Catholics go to communion frequently and never seem to grow? Why? How can you not grow in fire when you touch fire himself? And it's our problem. We are the ones that put the obstacles. We don't love him enough. We are tied down to many attachments and sins. We're too distracted by the vanities and emptiness of this world. And even get chained down into sin. So we have to cut these things that separate us from God, especially all sin. The Holy Ghost says, take the axe to the root. Kill the roots. Then you'll kill the tree. Kill the roots of sin. And you'll kill the effects of sin. And we all have to apply the axe to the roots in all of us. We all have sins. We all have weeds to work on. Whatever the sins are, we got to pull them out and beg God to help us to break sin and attachments to sin. So we see in this Holy Gospel, our Lord is on the boat. And there's a massive storm. Nothing St. Peter would probably have never been through before than St. James and St. John. They were fishermen. I'm sure they knew many storms on the sea. But they also knew how to read the weather. They knew how to read the weather and get out of the way of storms. But this one was enormous. And St. Peter himself was scared. If he was used to riding on, he knew how to handle storms, but this one, he was scared. And the apostles, the ship was rocking from left to right, and it looked like it was going to just flip over. And once the boat flips over, it sinks, and then you're at the mercy of the waves. And I don't know if any of you have tried to swim in huge waves. It is not easy. And you get a full breath, and another wave hits, and you start swallowing water. And just when you're about to take a new breath, another wave hits. So the waves are hitting from all over, and it's easy to start choking, and it's easy to get tired, and it's easy to drown. And that's how many of our ancestors crossing the Atlantic Ocean to the Americas, many of them drowned, plus the icy waters of the Arctic. So our Lord is sleeping. Of all things, he's sleeping. And the apostles they see they're going to be flipping over and drowned unless they call on our Lord. Our Lord's sleeping, and they wake him up. Lord, save us, or we're going to perish. And our Lord actually rebukes them. So why? St. Gregory the Great says, our Lord with his human eyes was sleeping, but with his divine eye he had everything under control. His divine providence. He won't let a hair of your head fall. He won't let anything happen to you unless he wills it and permits it. And this is the kind of trust we need to have in our Lord. And he rises up, extends his arms, and the way our Lord must have done it, his majesty, his divine majesty, commanding with a powerful voice, commanding the waves and the sea to be calm. And within a flash of a second, it instantly calmed. And the apostles and those who were in the boat with them said, who in the world is this? Who is this man that even the weather obeys him? And not just, the fathers of the church don't say it was like 5 minutes for the winds to calm down and a few minutes for the waves to settle down. It wasn't that. The fathers of the church who knew the apostles, they say it was instant. An instant calm. So, can we not say Can we not say that the state of our Holy Catholic Church now is the ship that Christ established? This ship of the Catholic Church that Christ established is being hit by waves. And these waves are the attacks, of course, of the devil. These waves are the attacks of heresies. These waves are the attacks of modernism, which is the synthesis of all heresies. These waves hitting the Catholic Church now are persecutions from without. With, as St. John Bosco, in a vision, he saw the future, and he saw the state of the Catholic Church as a ship being blasted by bombs, being hit with pamphlets, books, radio waves, internet waves, etc., etc. These are all the attacks against the spouse of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is his Catholic Church. And St. John Bosco, he saw in the vision the church being attacked at every level. Submarines from below, ships from the sea, dive bombers from the air. And the bombs took the form of the press, usually the press, the Freemasonic press, that is, the newspapers, internet, the radio, etc., etc. All the attacks against the Holy Roman Catholic Church, against all that Christ taught, the mockery and blasphemies against the teachings of our Divine Lord. And the modern world does. The modern world spits on God's laws. So you tell someone you can't use God's name in vain. You can't say the name of Jesus Christ swearing and cussing, only with reverence and adoration. And most people laugh at that and say, who are you to tell me how I can talk? And none of us tell anyone how to talk. God tells us, you will not take my name in vain. And that's his divine law, but man can care less. It's God's divine law that we don't work manual work on Sunday. But who obeys that anymore? You see people cutting the grass. You see people raking leaves on Sunday when it's not necessary. Maybe in the north they got to shovel snow if they've been dumped on with several inches or feet just to get out. They have to shovel on a Sunday, okay, but not more than necessary. So God forbids manual labor on Sunday. And yet, who cares? Who cares? And these are the attacks at all levels against the holy faith, the holy Catholic faith, the ship of the church. But now we're in an advanced form of the storm right now. Because the enemies are not outside the church, as Pope Pius IX, Pope St. Pius X, Pope Leo XIII, Pope Pius XII, they were dealing with the enemies from without. But Pope St. Pius X already said the enemies are now in the intestines of the church, working within. And now we have bishops themselves, priests themselves, and even the head of the ship, the Pope himself, drilling holes into the ship to sink her. So what do we do? How do you stay calm? Our Lord seems to be sleeping, doesn't he? We call upon him. We ask the Blessed Mother, help us. When are you going to put an end to this terrible crisis of the church? This confusion, this rife, and the modernism destroying everything. When, Blessed Mother, are you going to have your victory and step in and give us a pope that will finally obey what you asked at Fatima to consecrate Russia by name with all the bishops of the world? And she promises heaven will flood the earth with graces. Only then. So we're at the peak of the storm right now. And we wonder and say, how much worse can it get? And yet our Lord sleeps in peace. But he's always watching. And the Virgin Mary, she's preparing her next victory. But look at the storm also that she went through. The Blessed Virgin Mary, she went through many, many storms in her earthly life. 7 big ones. And the biggest of them all was the Passion. And imagine the ship of her pure soul being bombarded, hearing the pounding of the nails, hearing the scourging of the whips, tearing the sound even of the whips and the spikes, tearing out the flesh of our divine Lord, and the blood splashing all over the soldiers, which it did, and streams of it splashing onto the ground when our Lord was suspended up on the pulley and the pillar of the scourging, which now stands in St. Praxedes Cathedral Basilica in Rome, where Archbishop Lefebvre used to go love to pray. That pillar still stands, but it was tied to a pulley up and another pulley here, and the body was suspended. And our Lord was violently scourged in the front and in the back. And the Virgin Mary, hearing those scourges, Blessed Mary of Agreda says the Virgin Mary went through the very suffering our Lord went through in a mysterious way. And then she heard all the blasphemies, all the mockery, all the insults against Jesus Christ, the true God and the true King. She heard also all the rocks being thrown at him. When he was carrying the cross through the streets, she heard the eggs breaking on him, cabbage, tomatoes, rotten food thrown at Christ, because the Jews blocked the streets and they wanted to drag our Lord through the streets so they could mock him more. She heard the kicks against his sacred face, against his sacred body. When our Lord fell, they would swarm him, as the Psalm 21 says, a pack of bulls have surrounded me. Savage dogs have encompassed me. And that's what happened. They would surround our Lord and kick him in the side. So that the Shroud of Turin shows that Christ's kidneys even stopped working. That's how violently they kicked him. And the uric acid came out through his pores of his flesh. That's why the Shroud of Turin has such a vivid imprint, even on the negative. And then the Virgin Mary, she was in this storm of all the passion. And then to hear the pounding of the nails and a sound that maybe we don't think about, but crucifixion is a position of suffocation. You can't breathe. And to breathe, it's a torture to breathe. Because the body of the victim, and in this case our Divine Lord, in his divine human nature, he's hanging on the cross, and to breathe he has to push down on the nail in his feet, and the feet are full of over 22 nerve centers, and then pull down on the nails in his hand, in his wrist, on his right hand, the nail was pounded through the wrist, right through the median nerve. So take a bite of ice cream tonight and let it sit on your teeth till it hurts. That's an idea of the pain of the nerves. And imagine cold steel pounded through right in the middle of the injuring the very nerve center. The pain is indescribable. And our Lord, to get a breath, he had to pull down on those nails, scrape his ripped up back against the wood of the cross, splintering more deep splinters into his already ripped up back, and then to scrape his crown of thorns in the back against the back of the cross. So all the wounds of the thorns that were pierced into his sacred head and his skull, and even into part of his eye, all of that was constantly bleeding and constantly irritated for 3 excruciating hours on the cross, just to get one breath. So imagine the heart of the Virgin Mary standing at the foot of the cross, seeing this constant stream of blood, and then hearing him whistle to try to breathe. I think any mother would crush. It would just crush her heart just to hear their own son or their daughter trying to get breath to breathe. That's a torture in itself. And I've seen it as a priest, dying kids in front of their mother. And the mother's heart is broken. So the Virgin Mary, she was in a different kind of storm. It was the storm of our sins, the insults of the world, and the attacks of the devils against our Lord Jesus Christ. And yet, the Virgin Mary, in that storm, she never lost the faith. The apostles did. St. Peter lost the faith. He denied our Lord 3 times. All the other apostles, the first bishops of the Catholic Church, took off running and denied him. She never lost the faith. She never doubted once that he was truly God and that somehow he's going to rise from this. Somehow he's going to conquer death. She didn't quite know how, but she knew it would happen. And that's really, we get to taste this now. The state of the church now, just completely abandoned, completely ripped up, completely overtaken by the enemies of Christ. And it seems like our Lord, where are you, Lord? But we know the Catholic Church is divine because Christ founded it. We know the papacy is sacred in spite of its human frailties and sins and scandals of those who fill the chair of St. Peter. Yet the position is established by Christ. And Pope Francis holds his authority. But he'll answer to Christ for the abuse and the scandal he's causing by the abuse of his authority. That goes for all the bishops and priests of the world. They will have a lot to answer before Christ. So the Virgin Mary, she always knew Christ would solve this somehow. But her storm didn't end when Christ died on the cross. That wasn't the end of her sorrows. In a way, it was still only the beginning. Because then Longinus, the soldier, will pierce open his heart. And that piercing of his heart, which was now dead, but Christ's soul at 3 o'clock when he died on Good Friday, his soul went down to the belly of the earth. As he said, as Jonas entered the belly of the whale, so the Son of Man will enter into the belly of the earth. Where did he go? To the hell of the fathers. It's called the limbo of the fathers. He didn't go to the hell of the damned. He didn't go to purgatory. He went to the limbo of the fathers. That's one of the higher levels of hell. And they don't suffer. And that's where Christ went. To console and bring the joy to all the saints of the Old Testament. So from Adam and Eve until Christ died on the cross. Yet the Virgin Mary, at the foot of the cross, her heart was pierced. She felt that wound in her heart, and it was one of the heaviest hits. All the saints say, St. Albert the Great, St. Bernardine of Siena, St. Thomas Aquinas, they all say, the Virgin, St. Bernard especially, that she should have died right there. The fact that she could stay alive was a miraculous intervention of God, that the Virgin Mary could sustain all this. And St. Bernardine of Siena says, if the Virgin Mary parceled out right now to every single human being on the earth just a little drop of the suffering that she went through in her martyrdom at the foot of the cross, which she shared with our Divine Lord, it would kill the whole human race. That's what St. Bernardine of Siena. Everyone would just die. They would just die from the shock of suffering. So we'll never comprehend what she suffered. But we do know she went through a massive storm and it didn't stop. She held when she saw the body of our Lord taken down from the cross. Remember, in Spain, one of the great relics of the Catholic Church is the very towel of Oviedo, it's called. There's an Oviedo, Florida, probably named after that town in Spain. And that towel was wrapped around the Christ's head on the cross by Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus. And as they unhinged the nails in his hands and in his feet and took down his body, our Lord bent over and all the blood in his lungs that were left and water poured out of his mouth and nose. And that towel holds that precious blood. And it matches this, exactly the blood on the shroud and on the veil of Metapelo, which is most likely the veil of St. Veronica. These three relics. And the Virgin Mary saw our Lord's body lowered. They laid his dead body in her arms. So I have seen a mother holding her dead son. And as a priest, I have to say that's probably the most touching thing I've ever seen. A mother holding her son who just died in the hospital. And she's weeping over her son. He was an 11-year-old boy. But it won't even come close to what the Virgin Mary endured and suffered. And her tears would have wiped off a lot of the blood of the wounds. And then when she saw the wound of the opened heart, that just nearly, it should have killed her. She's called Queen of Martyrs, you know. But she never was killed for the faith. But her martyrdom was the passion. And then, yet, she never doubted he was God. She never doubted he would rise from the dead. Not one doubt. She was as firm as a rock pillar that doesn't budge. And that's the Virgin Mary. And yet, her faith was immovable, unshakable. But she still suffered all Friday night, hearing the waves, just like the ship bombarded by waves. She heard the waves of constant mockery, blasphemies, our Lord trying to breathe on the cross for 3 hours. All that she heard all night long. She didn't sleep. No way on Good Friday. She didn't sleep at all. And then the whole day, Saturday, she goes back and walks through the whole way of the cross. And drenching everywhere where she saw the scourging, the crowning with thorns, the carrying of the cross, our Lord's falls, his stripping at the foot of the cross, his being nailed to the cross and hanging there for 3 hours. Everywhere she re-soaked it with her tears. So the storm didn't end for the Virgin Mary until maybe she fell asleep Saturday night. Just so overwhelmed, she probably had some kind of rest. But it wasn't a real rest for her until at 3 a.m, Easter Sunday, Christ filled her room with his light and came to her with his resurrected body. And all the wounds and all the swellings and bruises and lacerations from the scourging, all miraculously cured. His flesh was just like the day he was born on Christmas night, supple and white. And holy and completely healthy, except the scars. He kept the scars in his hands and feet and his side. So then the storm for the Virgin Mary came to a perfect calm. So it's going to be through the Virgin Mary, God wants it this way, that the church will recover the faith, that the church will recover her prestige, we could say, her esteem among the angels and men, and rise from this mud of heresy and modernism, destroying our church from within and from without. And she promises this victory at Fatima, at La Salette, and we're in the storm of the church now, and this is more than ever the time we've got to go close to the heart of Mary, and then adore our Lord Jesus Christ through her eyes. Love him with her heart, because she's the only one that loved him perfectly. Of all the angels and saints, only the Virgin Mary loves him in a way that most pleases God. So we want to ask her, give me some of your fire. Teach me more and more about our Lord, that I might know and love him more and more. And in this terrible mess of the church today, God wants us to suffer with him. We are suffering, every one of us. We want an end to this. We want the Pope to be a good Pope and stop being a bad Pope. We want the bishops to stop being scandalous and destroying the sheep and leading them to hell. We want the good bishops to be good bishops. Like Archbishop Lefebvre, we need 1,000 Archbishop Lefebvre all over the earth who stood for the faith and were good bishops. And the church has met many thousands and thousands of canonized saintly bishops who lived in these last 2,000 years of the church history. And they were great, just great. St. John Newman of Philadelphia, who would walk on foot all the way to Buffalo, New York, to take care of the sheep and teach them the faith and confirm and ordain priests. These were good bishops, but now they're a scandal. So even our traditional bishops, we gotta pray that at least one of them rise up and teach the faith the way they're supposed to and defend the flock the way they're supposed to. But until that day comes, we gotta just hang on in this storm. And even though the storm rages outside, let there be in your heart and in your mind a great peace. The peace that the Virgin Mary knew even amidst the storm of her great suffering. So let's ask the Mother of God, reconsecrate ourselves to her. And she told Juan Diego, St. Juan Diego, in Guadalupe in 1531, she said to him, "My little Juanito," my little Johnny would be equivalent to in English, "My little Johnny, don't you know I hold you in my mantle, in my arms? Don't you know I'm your mother? Do you have any worries? Do you have anything to ask from your mother?" This is the Mother of God speaking to him. And she says the same to us. "Do you have any worries? Don't you know I'm your mother? Don't you know I hold you in the mantle of my arms?" And that's where we want to be in this storm. She is an army, she's like an army dressed for battle. Terrible to the devils is the role of the Virgin Mary. And Satan hates her, because whoever goes to the Virgin Mary will never see the fires of hell. That's a fact. Because our Lord has such a love for his mother, he has such respect for her. As Solomon elevated his mother and had her sit right next to him, as queen of all of Israel, Christ in heaven has his mother sitting right next to him and venerated by all the angels. And she points to Christ as God. She says, "Love my son, love him with all your heart, and be willing to die for him and fight for him." So in this storm of the church, and you young people, you're growing up in this storm. We all do. I think every one of us in this room have been born after Vatican II, almost. And so we don't know a time of the church in peace. We don't know a time of the church with a good pope defending and teaching the faith, and good bishops, and good priests everywhere. We don't know those days. Some of you might remember the tail end of those days, if you were taught by nuns or brothers. But those days are gone now, and we have to rebuild. You must be the new wave of saints of this time. And the Catholic Church always rises again through 10 persecutions, constant attacks down the history of the church. She always sails on, and Christ promises the gates of hell will not prevail. They will not prevail. It looks like they're almost winning, but they're not going to win. And that's why we have to rebuild everything. The Catholic family, monks, monasteries, nuns with convents, seminaries with good formation of good priests, Catholic families and Catholic hospitals, Catholic orphanages, and the taking care of the sick and the poor that were all started in the United States by the nuns. The ones, the first hospitals, the first nurses in the United States were the Catholic sisters. That's a fact of history. And on the Civil War battlefields, who were out there taking the wounded from both the North and the South and taking care of them all with the love of Christ? It was the Catholic sisters. And many of them converted on their deathbed because of the devotion of those nuns. And This is what the world needs to see again. Virgins consecrated to Christ, who will marry Jesus Christ, give their life to him, and one good sister shakes the world. One priest, one bishop shakes the world, let alone what one good pope can do. And that will come again. We will have again a good pope who will condemn Vatican II, condemn the new mass, condemn all the errors again that have already been condemned, and reignite the divine fire of the holy faith and consecrate the whole world, and especially Russia, to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. This is going to happen again. It's foretold. So let this time of the trials of the church be for us the occasion to really grow in the love of God and not be discouraged, but pick up your weapons of the rosary, the scapular, the holy faith, and fight on. Oh, little flock, fight on, little flock, for our faith is the victory over the world. O Mary, conceived without sin.
Pray for us,
O Mary, conceived without sin.
Pray for us,
O Mary, conceived without sin.
Pray for us,
in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.